Welcome to the Holy Land and this biblical site of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. We're going to be showing you all about this church and telling you all about it. So I think you'll find this very, very interesting, this video.
Now, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre is the most important site in Christianity. It is visited by over 1 million people each year. So in this video, we are going to do something unique. There have been so many changes to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre over the years that it is hard to picture how Calvary and the burial tomb of Christ would have looked in its original state. To better help you understand this place, we are going to take a trip back in time and show how it has developed from the beginning until now. Along the way, we will talk about the rich history that reveals why this site is indeed the authentic place where Christ was crucified, buried, and rose from the dead. We will also end with a special faith lesson of reflection. So sit back and enjoy this video that will include some animation to bring this site to life. Now, we have other videos that will show the details and places inside the church you might want to look at as well. So let's take a trip back in time. The place of Calvary was once a stone quarry that supplied stone for the building of the temple and so forth. During the time of Christ, there was a gate to Jerusalem called the Geneth Gate, which means Garden Gate. This gate has been discovered in recent times. It is in a little different location than the Jerusalem model shows, as the model was built before the gate was discovered. Josephus makes mention of this gate in his historical writings as well. Josephus was a Jewish historian during the time of Christ. There was a road that passed by the stone quarry for travelers entering and leaving Jerusalem. Because the quarry had fallen out of use for many years before Christ, it slowly developed into a garden and had a cistern and pool of water close by. Some of the rock was left, and upon it, the Romans crucified people. Part of this rock can still be seen today in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. This quarry place and garden was an ideal place because it was just outside the city and located on a well-traveled road. The Romans crucified people in the most visible places as possible, so all would learn what would happen to them if they disobeyed Roman laws. There were also tombs in the rock faces that were used for burials at this site. Now, Scripture states in John 19:20 that the place of crucifixion was near the city of Jerusalem. So this place fits the biblical narrative well. It says, "Therefore, many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city." And it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. This is John 19:20. Substantial remains of the first wall have been found in the Jewish quarter of the old city today. In these latter excavations, the remains of the Geneth Gate, or Garden Gate, and the beginning of what is believed to be the second wall have been found, just where Josephus described them as being. The name Garden Gate indicates that a garden must have been located nearby the city. Excavations below the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and the Lutheran Church of the Redeemer show that this area used to be an ancient quarry, which was later abandoned. The excavators believe that the area was then filled with good soil, presumably to turn the ugly quarry remains into a beautiful garden. An additional area by the rock quarry became a cistern as the city developed. From the Gospels, we know that Jesus was crucified in a place called Calvary and buried in a garden that was in the same location as Joseph of Arimathea's tomb was located. The front wall of the tomb faced east so the early morning sun could illuminate it. According to Hebrews 13:12, Jesus was crucified outside the city. So once again, this place was just outside the city on a well-traveled road. Now, some people have a problem that the place of crucifixion and the tomb of Jesus are so close together in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. However, John 19:41 states that Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So scripture clearly indicates that the crucifixion and tomb were nearby to one another. According to tradition, the early Christian community of Jerusalem worshiped at this site of the crucifixion from the time of the resurrection until 135 AD, when the Roman Emperor Hadrian destroyed and rebuilt Jerusalem. Visiting the burial sites of the rabbis was a common practice that is even done to this day by the Jews. So there is no doubt that the early Christians would have visited the place where Christ died and rose again as well. And I have been to Jerusalem many times, and I see sites all over the place on the Mount of Olives and famous rabbi tombs where the Jews to this day still visit famous rabbis. With this being the case, it is absolutely certain that the early Christians would have visited Jesus' tomb and knew exactly where it was at. There was no one like Jesus, so his followers knew once again exactly where Golgotha was and venerated it. There is no way this spot would have been lost or forgotten by them. For example, shortly after the resurrection of Christ, the upper room was converted into a church, and the apse, an apse is a half round circle with a dome shape on top of it, pointed toward the crucifixion, burial, and resurrection place of Christ. This gives significant evidence that this place was venerated and visited early on after Christ's resurrection. Because this place was so important, the apse of the upper room church pointed toward the place of the crucifixion and resurrection, and not the temple, which was on the Temple Mount. Another interesting fact is that there are also burial tombs in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre that date to the time of Christ. They are of the type that were used from about 37 BC to around 70 AD. These tombs clearly indicate that this area had tombs and was outside the city of Jerusalem during the time of Christ, as regular people were not buried within the city. Now, about 10 years after the crucifixion of Christ, another wall was built by King Herod Agrippa I that enclosed the area of Christ's crucifixion, burial, and resurrection within the city. This accounts for why the Holy Sepulchre is located inside the old city walls of Jerusalem today. But during the time of Christ, the crucifixion site and tomb were located outside the city. Once again, today they are located inside because of a wall that King Agrippa I built about 10 years after the time of Christ. The next significant event that affected the place of the crucifixion and resurrection was a major Jewish rebellion against the Romans. This rebellion was called the Bar Kokhba Revolt, and this happened in around 132 AD. Because of this revolt, the Roman Emperor Hadrian destroyed much of Jerusalem and changed its orientation. He renamed the city Aelia Capitolina and renamed the country to Palestine, which was a Philistine name. His desire was to erase the Jewish connection to the land because of the Jews' continual rebellions and uprisings. He constructed a main street that ran north and south called the Cardo Maximus. Cardo means heart or center of. He also desecrated the place of the crucifixion and resurrection that had been venerated by the early Christians, and in its place, he built a large platform that filled in the quarry and had upon it a large temple dedicated to Jupiter and Aphrodite. Aphrodite was an ancient Greek goddess of sexual love and beauty, identified with Venus by the Romans. Hadrian was so intent on destroying any connection to the land by the Jews and Christians that he buried all the evidence of the crucifixion and tomb of Christ under the platform that housed his large temple to Jupiter and Venus. Hadrian laid out the new city of Jerusalem so that the major streets led to his temple to Jupiter and Venus, which again were over the remains of the crucifixion and tomb of Christ. Eusebius, the Bishop of Caesarea in Israel, who lived from 260 to 339 AD, gave a chronological account of the development of early Christianity from the first century to the fourth. He was an eyewitness to some of the events Hadrian did and wrote down what he saw. Regarding the desecration of the crucifixion and tomb of Christ, Eusebius says, "The Romans brought a quantity of earth from a distance with much labor and covered the entire spot and buried it. Then, having raised this to a moderate height, they paved it with stones." Now, what Eusebius is describing is the raised platform Hadrian built upon which he would erect his temple to Jupiter and Venus. This platform had retaining walls all around it, of which some can still be seen today inside the church. Also, some of the stairs leading up to the temple of Hadrian can be seen today as well in the lower part of the church to the east. Eusebius goes on to say that the monument of his most holy passions, so long ago buried beneath the ground. So here he's describing the place of the crucifixion and tomb of Christ that were buried by Hadrian. Hadrian also minted a coin depicting the temple he built upon Golgotha. The temple of Hadrian would remain in place for another 200 years or so until the time of the Roman Emperor Constantine. Now let's see what Jerome says about the fact that Hadrian's temple was located on the top of the crucifixion and tomb site of Christ. Now Jerome lived from 347 to 420 AD. He established a monastery at Bethlehem and translated the Hebrew Bible into Latin. Bethlehem is very close to Jerusalem, so Jerome was an eyewitness to what he writes. Here's what Jerome tells us. From the time of Hadrian to the reign of Constantine, the spot which had witnessed the resurrection was occupied by a figure of Jupiter, while on the rock where the cross had stood, a marble statue of Venus was set up by the heathen and became an object of worship. The original persecutors indeed suppose that by polluting our holy places, they would deprive us of our faith in the Passion and in the Resurrection. So Jerome confirms that from the time of Hadrian until Constantine, the temple Hadrian built was located on the top of Golgotha, on the very places where Christ was crucified and rose again. So in the place where Christ died for the sins of humanity, Hadrian set up a temple to false gods who promoted deep immoral sin. So what a contrast. In 313 AD, a major change happened in the Roman Empire when Constantine legalized Christianity. Later, because his mother was so passionate about Christ, she made a trip to the Holy Land to build churches over the main events of Christ's life. She built the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem, the Church of the Ascension on the Mount of Olives, which is currently known as the Paternoster Church, the Church of Annunciation in Nazareth, and the Church of the Holy Sepulchre here in Jerusalem. The Roman Emperor Constantine had the temple Hadrian had erected to Jupiter and Venus demolished to make way for the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. In the process of the demolition, the tomb and crucifixion site of Jesus were uncovered once again, and the Church of the Holy Sepulchre was erected. Additionally, Constantine's mother Helena is claimed to have discovered the relic of the cross of Jesus at this time. The church was dedicated in 335 AD. Now Eusebius, who we referred to earlier, describes the destruction of Hadrian's temple by Constantine. Here's what he says. As soon as his, meaning Constantine's, commands were given, these engines of deceit were cast down from their proud eminence to the very ground, and the dwelling places of error, with the statutes and the evil spirits which they represented, were overthrown and utterly destroyed. Nor did the emperor's zeal stop here, but he gave further orders that the materials of what was thus destroyed, both stone and timber, should be removed and thrown as far from the spot as possible. And this command was also speedily executed. Eusebius continues, "The emperor, however, was not satisfied with having proceeded thus far. Once more, fired with holy ardor, he directed that the ground itself should be dug up to come to a considerable depth, and the soil which had been polluted by the foul impurities of demon worship transported to a far distant place. This was also accomplished without delay, and as soon as the original surface of the ground beneath the covering of the earth appeared, immediately the venerable and holy monument of our Savior's resurrection was discovered. Then indeed did the most holy cave," referring to the tomb, "present a faithful similitude of his return to life, and that after lying buried in darkness, it again emerged to light and afforded to all who came to witness the sight a clear and visible proof of the wonders of which that spot once had been seen. A testimony to the resurrection of the Savior, clearer than any voice could give." Eusebius then speaks about the Church of the Holy Sepulchre that Constantine built. Here's what he says. "Accordingly, on the very spot which witnessed the Savior's suffering, a new Jerusalem was constructed, where at the side opposite to the sepulchre, Jesus' tomb, was the eastern side. The church itself was erected, a noble work rising to a vast height and a great extent in length and breadth." Eusebius then goes on to describe the construction of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre by Constantine. "Thereupon, the emperor issued sacred edicts, and when he had provided an abundant supply of all of the things required for the project, he gave orders that a house of prayer worthy of God should be erected round about the cave of salvation." So he's speaking about the tomb. "And on the scale of rich and imperial costliness, to be greater than anything else that had been built on earth." So what we have described here is that Constantine built a large mausoleum over the place of the tomb. A mausoleum is a structure designed for burial or entombment above the ground. And he also built the Basilica of the Martyrium and the open courtyard. Now, the Church of Constantine was laid out in three sections. The first main part was a place called the Basilica of the Martyrium, and it led up from the Cardo Maximus upstairs to this church. And it was a large area. Now, martyrium is taken from the word martyr, and the apse of the church faced west. So this was the main meeting area, the main church area of Constantine's buildings. Just outside the Church of the Martyrium and before the rotunda covering, which is also called a mausoleum, was an open courtyard. And this was called the triportico because it had three sides with covered walkways. Just to the left of this open courtyard was the crucifixion site of Christ. Now, I should mention that some believe that the crucifixion site was located in the apse part of the Basilica of the Martyrium and not in the courtyard. However, both places are just a few feet away, so it's really not that important. I should also mention that part of the Rock of Golgotha is still preserved today and is in the place where the courtyard was and not in the church part where the apse is. Just beyond the open courtyard was the large rotunda covering the tomb of Christ. This is also called a mausoleum or anastasis. The tomb was initially carved out of the rock and preserved. And you can see an example of this in Absalom's monument in the Kidron Valley. So the tomb was carved out of the rock and preserved in its natural state at this time. The crypt, or Cistern of the Crosses, was under the Basilica of the Martyrium, venerating Golgotha. Another eyewitness account that the Church of the Holy Sepulchre was located on the site of the crucifixion and tomb of Christ comes from the Pilgrim of Bordeaux from 333 AD. And this witness says, "On your left is a little hill of Golgotha where the Lord was crucified. About a stone's throw from it is the crypt where they laid his body and from where he rose again on the third day. These are present by order of Constantine. There has been built a basilica that is a church of wondrous beauty." So this witness describes in part the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. We also have another pilgrim's account of a worship service in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre that comes from 380 AD. They say, "I know you were eager to know about the services they have daily in the holy places. I shall tell you about them. When the first cock has crowed, the bishop straightway enters and goes into the tomb and the Anastasis. Anastasis means resurrection and is the round, rotunda dome place in the church over the tomb of Christ." He continues, "And the whole crowd streams into the Anastasis, which is already ablaze with many lamps. Then the bishop, standing inside the screen, takes the gospel and advances to the door of the tomb where he himself reads the account of the Lord's resurrection. When the gospel is finished, the bishop comes out and is taken with hymns to the cross, and they all go with him to the great church, the Martyrium. The people assemble in the great church built by Constantine upon Golgotha." So we have many eyewitness accounts of people who clearly saw and claim that this place where the Church of the Holy Sepulchre was the place where Christ was crucified, buried, and rose again, and that Hadrian built a temple upon it to cover everything up, and then Constantine uncovered everything and built a new church over it to venerate this site. Another amazing piece of evidence is found at the Basilica of Santa Pudenziana, which is recognized as the oldest place of Christian worship in Rome. In the apse of the building is a mosaic of Christ and the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in the background. So we actually have a photo of what Constantine's Church of the Holy Sepulchre in part looked like. This is strong evidence as well for the authenticity of this site. During the Byzantine period in around 560 AD, a mosaic map in Madaba, Jordan was built using more than 2 million pieces of colored stone tiles. This is the oldest map in existence of the Middle East. In part of the map of the city, Jerusalem can be seen. In this map of Jerusalem, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre can be seen in the very location that it is today. This is another piece of astounding evidence for the true location of the church here at this site. Well, I hope that you have enjoyed this video. I hope that you have found it significant to see all that has transpired here, all of the witnesses, all of the evidence that points to the fact that this is indeed the place where Christ died, was buried, and rose again. In part two of this video series, we'll be looking at all of the amazing events that took place from 614 AD until the present. So be sure to check that video out. Well, thank you for listening and watching, and may God richly bless you.